Hello, and welcome to today's webinar from Element14 collaboration with the Elektor Academy. Today's presentation will be discussing analog circuit design in LabVIEW. Without further ado, I'll turn it over to our presenters.
There we are. Your presenters today are Roy Aarts, sitting next to me.
Hi.
I understand that there is no video, but I pinch him. He is there next to me, and he's a trainee at Elektor, and he has been working on this project. My name is Clemens Varens, and I will co-present this webinar with Roy. What is analog circuit design? This webinar is about doing analog circuit design with LabVIEW, but what is analog circuit design? Analog circuit design is designing circuits using manipulating analog signals. Usually you do this with analog components, can be ICs, can be discrete components, transistors, resistors, capacitors, etc. But it's quite involved. For most people, it's more involved than digital electronics, even though that complex digital electronics is, of course, difficult too. Here we have a schematic on this slide of
an amplifier, an analog amplifier. You can see the number of components used to get a good sound quality and a good power out of this amplifier. It is daunting to design such a circuit, and we do not have the intention to tell you how to do this now, but we will give you some tools to get started and maybe do this in the future. Okay, here you can see the difference between digital design and analog design. It's the same function, it's an inverter. On the left, we have a digital gate. For a digital designer, it's simple, it's B is not A. On the right, it's much more complicated. It's not just a triangle with a dot, but it's two transistors and two resistors, and there are mathematical formulas involved. Okay, so analog design is difficult. Most people know that it's difficult or think it's difficult, and I agree it is difficult even for simple things, because the signals that you are using, that you are manipulating, are not easy. They are variable between a minimum level and a maximum level. They are not clean. There is noise on it. There is interference from other things. In here in this studio we have lights that interfere with the circuit that we may have on the table, making the functioning of the circuit uncertain. Noise is really a difficult problem. You get noise on every frequency. This will have a negative impact mostly on your circuit. Another problem is, of course, components. The components that are not ideal. They are, when you at school you learn that components function in a certain way, but in reality they almost function that way, but not exactly. So you have to take into account that too. A digital gate, an inverter usually will invert. There are some delays, etc., that you should take into account, of course. But in an analog circuit, it's much more important to consider tolerances, etc. Then to make a prototype, you have to set up a circuit, either solder it on a board, but you have lots of components, or use a breadboard, like we have on this photograph. But breadboards are notably unreliable. Contacts are usually bad, worn out, resulting in bad conduction. Signals will be distorted, will introduce noise, or there will be no signal at all. And again, your circuit will not work. And then finally, before we continue with the main board, analog design involves mathematics. And a lot of people have learned mathematics at school, at university, but a lot of people also liked a lot to forget this mathematics, and they do not want to use it anymore. They only kept a small amount of useful functions and useful mathematical knowledge that they use every day. And yeah, as this drawing is a bit exaggerated, but you have to do mathematics if you want to do analog design. Okay, then of course you need tools. Tools are expensive and you need a lot of them. You need an oscilloscope. You can do without, but an oscilloscope is really handy. You need a multimeter, of course, to measure the currents, the voltages, impedances, etc. A function generator, several if possible, and a good power supply. You really need a good power supply, stable, noise-free, because the quality of the power supply has an influence on the quality of your circuit. But this is where we go to there we are. There are solutions not to solve all these problems I don't know the expression exactly. But we can make it easier, and that is where Roy comes in, because Roy, he has developed this board, the board that you see on the left, which we call the opamp Minikit. Roy, please tell us something more about it.
This is the opamp Minikit, which we have developed here at the Elektor. It's a Minikit which can be used with the myDAQ. It's an opamp Minikit to test several opamp configurations. It connects to the myDAQ at the site, and can then be used with a program in LabVIEW. And that way you can test several opamp configurations using one PCB.
Okay, so the Minikit, the circuit board that we see on the left, is a programmable opamp circuit. Reconfigurable opamp circuit. And the myDAQ is an interface that connects the mini circuit to LabVIEW, which runs on your PC and which functions as the display.
Yeah.
Okay. Now you have to do page down.
What is LabVIEW? LabVIEW is a data flow programming language. In LabVIEW, to make such a program, you drag blocks, which are the functions and mathematical functions, to your screen and connect them with lines. Those lines there, they represent the signals flowing between those blocks.
Okay, so it's a graphical programming language where the connections between the blocks are signals and not it's data. We will see an example, if I'm not mistaken, at the end of this presentation of a LabVIEW program.
Yeah.
So you can see more, will be more.
Yeah, and you see the program which runs, which controls the OBAT Minikit.
And the myDAQ, which is a key element in this system.
Yeah, the myDAQ is a low-cost data acquisition device. It's low-cost in comparison to all the tools you saw before, which are needed to make an analog circuit. The myDAQ combines several instruments in one small package.
Is that on the next slide?
It combines, it combines a power supply with plus and minus 15 volts and 5 volts for the digital logic.
Then it has
8 digital I/O pins, which can be controlled. Then it has an analog input, 2 analog inputs and audio input, and 2 analog outputs and audio output. And on the bottom, there's a digital multimeter.
Yes, a multimeter has a typical multimeter connectors, banana sockets, so you cannot mistake it for something else. And of course, what is really important about the myDAQ, it's extremely small.
Yeah,
it's very portable compared to...
Compared
to the photo of the workbench you saw, this is really very small.
Yeah, it can be taken anywhere where a laptop can go. To use the myDAQ in LabVIEW, you have to install the drivers. This is and the program is called the National Instruments LabVIEW. When you install it, you can you're ready to use the myDAQ in LabVIEW.
Okay, so this program is standalone, and it is also the driver in LabVIEW.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so the Minikit.
Yeah, the Minikit is meant for education. It's a tool for teachers and students to learn or teach the basics of op amps. On the board, there are 10 different configurations which are selectable with the digital I/O pins on the myDAQ. Those pins control analog multiplexers which switch components for the op-amp. The signal, the input signal, is also generated by the myDAQ, and the output goes back also to the myDAQ and is displayed in the LabVIEW program.
To be sure, these blocks that I see here inverting means this is an op-amp configured as an inverting amplifier, right?
Yeah. So those blocks represent the op-amp configurations which can be switched.
Okay. Please continue.
This is
nice colors.
The a block diagram of how it works. The red block is the main op-amp. Then you see the blue multiplexer. That one switches the component before the op-amp, where the analog output zero, the signal from that goes through first.
Yes, that multiplexer configures the inverting input of the op-amp.
Yeah. Then you see the green multiplexer. That one switches the component on the feedback loop. So for the inverting op-amp, for example, logarithmic. Then you have the yellow multiplexer that switches the analog output 1. That is also a signal which can be set, or the ground for some configurations. And the output of the op-amp goes back to the myDAQ inverted and non-inverted.
Okay. This is complicated.
This is what you saw before in a schematic. You see the red block is again the op-amp, the main op-amp, and above that is the green square that switches the component in feedback loop, and the blue square switches the component before the op-amp. Then you have the yellow block, which selects between the second signal or ground. And you see also a block which isn't colored. That one is for one function called playing with gain. It's almost the same as the inverting op-amp, but then with a potentiometer to change the gain of the op-amp.
Okay, so this is a nice example actually of a mixed signal design, because here we have analog design, the bits around the op-amp, controlled by digital signals to select the components that make up the configurations, the op-amp circuit.
Yes.
So it's almost as complicated as analog design only, or maybe more.
On the board additional connection points. On those points you can insert your own components. With those components you can change the values. So you get different results with the same configuration. You can also measure stuff on those points, but for that you do need an oscilloscope to measure those signals.
Yes, so if you want, because on the board by default I think you have mounted a 1 microfarad capacitor, for instance, which you use in your circuits. You think it's too big or too small, more or less, you can put another in parallel, but you can also connect an oscilloscope directly to the capacitor and measure what's going on there, because not everything is of course routed to the myDAQ, and visible in LabVIEW, only the input and output signals. So this gives you an extra degree of measurement freedom. That's right?
Yeah. This is the program in the LabVIEW. It's the user interface for which you control the op-amp kit. On the left, you can select which configuration you want to test. There are 10 different configurations. And beneath that, you see the simplified schematic of which configuration you are testing.
I will use the marking facility of. So this, now you should see a red arrow on your screen. this gray block, this is where you select your configuration, and then this is the configuration that you are using.
Yes.
Then you mentioned the sliders.
Those sliders, you can, with the checkboxes to the right of those sliders, you can select between a DC voltage or a sine wave, a triangle wave or a square wave.
Oh, that's fast.
That's fast. then with the slider you can set the voltage of the DC voltage or the amplitude of the one of the waves.
Yes, so this is the slider sets the input signal level, the amplitude or the signal up to 5 and minus 5. And you can do that for both channels.
Yes. And with the frequency you can you can set the frequency of the sine, triangle, or square wave.
And this is the frequency 0 to 100 is a percentage or it's.
No, it's hertz.
Hertz. So you can set it to 100 hertz.
Yeah.
Is this because of the limits of the MyDAQ or anything? Why only 100 hertz?
Because I thought you got the best result in the. Yeah.
Okay.
You got the best results.
Yes, if you like, you can go higher.
If your computer is fast enough, yes.
Ah, it's a computing question.
Yeah, I had trouble with computer with that. Yeah.
Okay, so and then we have these graphs here.
Those the first two graphs they show the input signal, the signal what you're sending to the to the op-amp kit.
Okay, input two, input one.
Yes, and on the right you. You see the results which you get back, the inverted result and the non-inverted.
This is the non-inverted?
Yeah.
And this is the inverted?
Yes, for the playing with gain function, which you're seeing now, it's different. The only output you're getting with that function is the above one.
The
top one.
Okay, but we will, you can maybe repeat that when we have that slide.
Yeah.
Anything else about the LabVIEW interface that is important to mention now?
Above the last two graph, the output graph, you see the value you're getting back from the MyDAQ in a number, as a number.
Oh, that's so a raw value, okay. Yeah. It's important to mention, I think, that this software, this VI in LabVIEW programs are called virtual instruments. You can download it from our website, it's open source, and then you can modify it and change it and adapt it to your needs.
Well, the different op-amp configurations. The first configuration is the inverting op-amp. The first checkbox. At the V1, is it? V1, the signal goes in, gets inverted, and gets output, goes to the output.
So we see, this is the input signal, this is the output signal, and then what's this signal?
That is the second input signal, but that isn't used in this configuration, so it's at zero.
Okay, so we have to be clear that this is the inverted signal of this one. So this one, the right bottom graph, doesn't have anything to do with the left bottom graph. Okay, we can see it's inverting because there's a phase shift between the input and the output signal. So the circuit is working.
Yep.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. Maybe also a note there, the board amplifies always with two.
That's difficult to see. It's difficult to see on the slides, but here is a minus one, and there's a plus one, and here is a minus two, and there's a plus two.
That's because of the resistor values of R1 and R2. R2 is 5K6, and R1 is 2K7, so that's it's half of R2.
Okay.
R1 is half of the R2.
Yeah, he clicked. We have to re-click in the slides. There we go.
The next one is the non-inverting op-amp configuration. This configuration uses the second signal.
This one.
Yeah.
Going there.
So At the V1, the signal goes to, into the op amp, and at VO, it comes out again. This one, also amplifies
three times. Yes, you can see it. Also here, if you look carefully, here we have a little bit more than 1 volt, and here we have a little bit. We are in between 2 and 4 there. So that is 3 volts. So again, it's correct.
Yes.
Well done. Next slide.
Next summing. Is the summing amplifier. I
get rid of my arrow here.
You see a square wave added to a sine wave. In the top right graph you see the non-inverted output, and at the bottom you see that same output but inverted.
So yes, you can nicely see how the sine is superimposed on the square wave. It would have been maybe even more clearer if you had used a higher frequency for the sine. Should have nice. Anyway, that's not important.
Yeah, can people try at home themselves?
Exactly, that's a good exercise to do at home. So download the code from the website. You will get the link at the end of the webinar, and give it a try at home. So what else do you have?
Then we have the differential amplifier.
My arrow out of the way. Yeah.
Here you again have a square wave and a sine wave, but then are subtracted from each other.
Yes, it's more difficult to see in subtraction and the difference between subtraction and an addition, of course, but I think it looks good to me, so I say thumbs up for Roy again.
Then we have the differentiator. The next configuration. This one uses a 1 microfarad capacitor at the beginning.
This one you mean C? The C is 1 microfarad, yes. And this one is
5k6.
Yes, so we have quite a small time constant, and we have quite low frequencies because this is 30 hertz, and this one is
not used.
So 30 hertz and low small time constant results in this kinds of peaks. And so, what kind of circuit is this, Roy?
A differentiator.
Yes, but if used like this, it's really a differentiator, but used a lot as a kind of filter.
It's a high pass filter can be used.
Exactly, this is a high pass filter.
Then we have the integrator.
There it goes.
It's the integrator. Used almost the same components. C is also 1 microfarad, but R is this time it's 2K7.
Yes, an integrator, as Roy knows, is a low pass filter.
Yeah.
We can see it here clearly in the graph. The input signal is a triangle, the output signal is a sine. The triangle has more harmonics than the sine. They are filtered out by this circuit, and the result is a sine. There is a DC offset, as you can see, because it's not around zero. This signal here, if you position the arrow correctly, is around zero, whereas here it is around three.
Yeah.
And that's a part, of course, of the integrator, the DC integration of the circuit. Okay, and then we have...
Now we have the...
Now we go into non-linear.
Yes, the logarithmic amplifier. This, for this I used a sine wave, but and at the output comes only the bottom half of the signal.
Let's we place the arrow here. The arrow is at zero, so you can see that the positive part is slightly above zero, so that's the positive halves. Well, it's inverting rectifier, so that's actually the negative half that's coming through. And this level is -5, so it's rectifying. So then you have the same circuit with the diode on the left.
It's the anti-logarithmic amplifier.
There it is.
So Yeah, almost the same as the previous. But this one, and in this case, outputs the other half of the sine wave, so also can act as a rectifier.
Now you have different frequencies here. This is 50 hertz, and this is on 30 hertz. The directory in this close, if you are in this bit where I place the arrow, then you are in the exponential part of the diode again. But since we have high, large signals, it will immediately clip to the power supply. Okay, what else do you have? I see more. There is another one there.
This
comparator.
One is a comparator. It compares the first and the first output signal of the MyDAQ with the second output signal.
So V1 and V2.
Yes. From the first one is a triangle wave, and the second one is a sine wave. So when the second, when the first signal is higher than the second signal, the comparator outputs one with a high 5-volt in this case.
Yeah, so when V2 is higher than V1, and it's a positive input, then the output will be positive.
Will be positive. Or else it it will be negative. So then you can get results like this. You can play around with it if you download the software yourself, so you can try it out. Then the last one is the playing with gain function. This was the separate function I showed before with the potentiometer. With the potentiometer, it is almost the same as the inverting amplifier. But then you can change the gain of the amplification.
Yes, it's again. It's a bit difficult to see, but here we have a level from -1 to +1, and here in the output it is from -2 to +2. And Roy informed me that R1 and R2 have the same value.
Yes.
So if P1 is here, if the slider is there, so it's shorted out, then the amplification should be 1. And since it is 2, the slider apparently is not at this position, but somewhere in the middle. I don't know the value of P1. So this circuit also is working,
yes,
which means that you presented 1, 2, 3, oh. No, that's okay.
Sorry. Well, those were the 10 configurations.
Okay, so this is the LabVIEW programming. This is the user interface that we saw. Huh?
Yeah, this is the block diagram that controls everything. At the right, works as a.
This right or this right? The right. This right?
Yes, that right. That one sends the input signals to the MyDAQ.
So this block, the light blue block, is the MyDAQ.
Yes, those light blue block, those are the connections with the MyDAQ. So the right half works as a function generator that generates the waves are DC voltages, which are sent to the MyDAQ to the opamp board. On the bottom in the middle, is actually the oscilloscope. It reads the input from the opamp. The output from the opamp goes to the input of the MyDAQ, and then is shown in those two graphs.
Oh yeah, this is the orange blocks are the raw values.
Yeah, those are the raw values. Yeah.
Okay.
And then the remaining parts are to select the different configurations. Those control the digital outputs, which control the multiplexers, switch the components for the op-amp. And beneath. We need the box is some additional blocks which show the picture of the configuration you are testing.
Yeah, this is actually a nice example of LabVIEW showing. This is a LabVIEW program showing how you can integrate an image. It's more or less image processing in the same program as processing an audio signal or just a signal and displaying it on an oscilloscope, using the same blocks and the same way of programming it. It's quite a funny way of, if you want to do this in normal programming language, then you have to type a lot. Okay, anything else that you can you want to say about this?
That was it.
Okay, well, we have to choose someone. Roy, you want to choose someone from the list who will receive the mini kit? You can.
Yes, I will choose Johan Spitzer. He will receive the opamp kit, which we
Okay, Johan Spitzer, if you are there, congratulations. We will contact you to get your address, your post address, so that we can send you this nice hand-soldered mini kit, hand-soldered by Roy. And I tried to convince him to sign it, but he has refused up to so far. But so maybe congratulations.
Johan,
yes, yeah. The name is Johan. Johan, yes. Thank you.
If you want more information, there are four links on this page. The top two of is the information for the Minikit, where you can download the VI.
Yes, the first link, to be more specific, is the link where you can find the project. So you can find the design files of the Minikit. You can find the circuit diagram and the PCB drawings. And also the software. I don't know if the software is there. In case it isn't, we have also put the software here. This is a temporary storage because it's only available there from people who can log in onto elektor.labs. As soon as the webinar will be online for offline viewing, which sounds a bit strange, we will put the software there too, so you can download the presentation with the software and review the video. Okay, and then we have these two links.
Those two are for more information about the myDAQ and the projects and experiments you can do with it.
Okay, so now we go to the Q&A. It's now you can now ask questions, and we will try to answer them. Oh, there are a lot of questions. It's all about the video that's not working. So then we have to find a question. Here we have a nice question. Okay, Roy, read it.
This question is from Don Bertke. How does the Minikit differ from the programmable analog components in the Cypress semiconductor PSOC4 devices?
You know about PSOC?
No.
No? Well, I happen to know about the PSOC devices. It differences in... it's a shame that the video is not working. But a PSOC device is a chip. And of course, you can. It's a chip with analog circuitry inside, and you can program the circuitry to do what you want to do it, but it doesn't have the measuring stuff inside, and if it breaks and you have to change all the whole chip, the Minikit is made of a discrete sort of components with ICs. You can change if you break something, and you can measure at points where you cannot measure in an IC. So, and also you don't need to learn any programming to configure the Minikit, because we did that for you in the LabVIEW application. But then again, PSOC 4 is very nice, and we should do a webinar about it once. Okay, here we have a question from Ruud Wessels. Can you use the points to change amplification values? And what are the points?
I think he may meant the point where you can change
the external connection points.
Yes, you can. If you insert other components, then you then you can indeed change the values.
Yes, you can also, because it is a through hole, you can remove the components in place and then only use the connection points to insert the parts that you like. Oh yeah, there's the sheet where you can see it.
On those circled parts, those are the points where you can insert the additional components. Then you change.
You can customize the board. We use the low frequencies, so we adapted the components to low frequencies because Roy had problems with LabVIEW on his poor old computer, and lower frequencies work better.
Yes.
But if you have a good, fast, modern laptop, then you can go to higher frequencies because the MyDAQ can go up to, I think, 20 kilohertz or something.
I don't know.
Another question.
From Johan van Dingen, who had won the Minikit or sound receiver?
Oh, okay, the sound. So
the person who won it was Johan Spitzer. So,
sorry, not van Dingen.
Yes, not Johan van Dingen. No, sorry, Johan. It's this is a Johan with two N's. Johan Spitzer, I suppose a German speaking visitor, a viewer. Which LabVIEW version are you using?
I was using a student version. I don't know exactly which version, but...
You installed it on this machine?
That's right.
I don't know if you can see it. We won't try to...
I thought it was the 2014 version. So.
Okay, but it's not depending on any version of LabVIEW. Your software will work with, should work with any version.
It should work with the...
Well, any version that supports the MyDAQ, of course. Yeah. Without... Here's another one. Nice work, Roy. I will read it for you, if I can see it. I can't seem to find the MyDAQ to be sold anywhere as a non-student. Is Elektor selling the hardware needed to us non-students? Well, this is a question from Marnix Jansen. This is a bit of a difficult point. We do sell the MyDAQ, indeed, but I think we only sell it in Germany. This is due to National Instruments policies. So that's not our... we try what we can. But we sell it in Germany to anybody. But in other countries, you cannot buy it. It's a bit strange situation. But we have this slide. The last. Can we go to the slide quickly to get the links again here? We got these links from National Instruments. And what this one is interesting, it's the MyDAQ Try link. That is, I think, a link where you can get more information on how to acquire a MyDAQ. So I suggest you go there and have a look. Time is up. One quick question I will answer from Fabian Waldman. Will we get a copy of the presentation? Yes, usually the presentation will be available together with the offline video recording of this webinar. And also the answers to the questions that are not answered today will be available there. Okay,
yeah.
Then I think we have one last slide, but I have to click into it.
Well,
thank you for attending and see you next time. I hope it was interesting for you. And of course, a round of applause for Roy. Well done.
Yeah, thank you.